This is the second part of our quick class about how to efficiently solve the rectilinear traveling salesman problem, or the picking problem in warehouses. Make sure you have seen the introductory video, which tells you everything about the problem itself and how it relates to a variety of traveling salesman problems. What I do today is I go directly to the algorithm. Recall these two examples we had in the introductory video. The algorithm starts with a simple property about a solution, about a tour. And it simply says that a valid tour has only vertices of even degree. And for instance, this vertex has degree 2, this one has degree 4. Similarly here, a degree 2 and a degree 4. You could have a degree 6 or 8, but a valid tour has only vertices of even degree. Second point is that it must be connected, so it must be made of a single connected component. And finally, it must visit the mandatory vertices, and so the cities or the products. This is the requirement of the Steiner TSP. So we must keep this property in mind because I will refer to it during this talk very often to justify the algorithm. Okay, a second point is that a tour can be directed at the end as a post-processing. If you are given an undirected tour like this one, you can easily give it a direction at the end to really see the trip of the picker in the warehouse, let's say. This is why the algorithm only considers undirected tour. We are trying to design a dynamic program, and in this case, a short space model. And the first question we have is always about the structure of an optimal solution. Is an optimal solution made of optimal solutions to smaller problems? So in this case, is an optimal tour made of optimal subtours? To see that, you can split the problem, for instance, with this gray separator. And notice that indeed, the subtour to the left of this separator must be an optimal partial subtour if this solution is to be an optimal tour. Indeed, I can get rid of this left part and actually plug a number of alternative subtours. For instance, this one would fit nicely in there. And it does fit nicely because it actually satisfies the property here. The parity of the degree is even, even, even. And we are left with a single connected component. And we are visiting all the mandatory vertices. So this subtour satisfies this property for the vertices in the separator. And this one would also fit in there. And of course, the one we considered initially also fit in there. Now, if you think about it, if this solution is to be optimal, then among all these possibilities, this one must be one of the shortest. So if I give you the distance of each subtour here, well, this one must have one of the shortest distance because this solution is actually assumed to be optimal. If not, we would have a contradiction here. So this is the key point of dynamic programming. Now, all we need to know to connect these subtours is about the parity of the degree of each vertex and the connected component to which they belong. And connected component 1 and 2. And this can be represented more efficiently like that, by E1, E1, E2, meaning even connected component 1, even connected component 1, and even connected component 2. So if you look at the subtours we had in there, well, they all have the same characteristic, yeah? Because they all fit the right part, and they all satisfy this property regarding the degree and the connected component. So this is the main point of the algorithm, if you see that. So there are many subtours here, but they all belong to the same class of equivalence. So we actually cannot enumerate all possible subtours, but we will be able to enumerate the equivalent classes. And the algorithm will find the shortest representative for each class. And there are many more subtours than classes of equivalence. And you can see an example here of such a class of equivalence. Okay, so this is the main idea of this algorithm. Alors, to complete the representation, we also need to encode where the separator is located. So here on L2 and 3. And there are many ways to do this separator, this splitting. It can be vertical, it can be like this, or it can be like this. These are the three shapes of the separator we consider in the algorithm. All right, to better understand what we are going to do here, I show you the end result, a glimpse of the end result. We are trying to express the problem as the shortest path in an acyclic layered graph. And you can see here the rectilinear TSP or the peaking problem. It works the same for both. And we are trying to cast it as the shortest path in this graph. And the vertex in this graph is a subproblem, is a partial subtour, and is represented with the characteristics we already mentioned. Now, if you notice, this graph is built by layers, so that the characteristic of a subproblem, which we talked about, we only need actually to keep this part. This part, the position of the separator, is actually implicit from the graph structure. As we move through the graph, we'll move from one subproblem to a bigger subproblem, and we will move the separator through the grid. So this information can be found from the structure of the graph. So I will focus on this part. Okay, let's say a bit more about the graph itself, and let's give some examples of its vertices and arcs. We already saw an example of a vertex. And you can see a second example here, where we have an odd degree, so u is for uneven or odd. We have a single connected component here, so we have u1, u1, and e2. Degree 3 is odd and uneven. Another example of a subproblem or a vertex is the following, where we have a degree 0, then we have a degree 4, so it's even, one connected component here, so e1 and e2. Now, these vertices are subproblems, and as we grow from one subproblem to a slightly bigger one, we are considering arcs in the graph. So let's have a look at the arcs. For instance, this subproblem here, E1, E1, E2, can be extended to this one by adding a horizontal transition here. And if the length of, in the warehouse, if the length of this path is 5, then the distance we put on the arc is actually 10 because we are adding a back a way back and forth here. So this is an example of an arc. And we can also see an example of adding a vertical transition, where we move from a subproblem here that is represented by 0, E1, E2, to a subproblem where we add this horizontal transition, and we have 0, u1, u1. So we have now a single connected component and uneven degrees. Now the distance here on the arc is again the distance of crossing a nail. So you can see that the arcs are representing one subproblem, a step forward from one subproblem to a slightly bigger one. So what I must do now is to look at the number of ways we have to extend one subproblem to another. And once I have done that, I will go for an example to help you understand the whole picture. So let's consider the possible ways to actually cross a nail. And let's look first at vertical nails. So here is a possible way to cross a vertical nail. And I have put the distance between two consecutive products here and the total distance of this trip here. This would be another option, going back and forth. This would be a third option, and so on. And there are a number of options when you stop in the middle. You can stop there, you can stop there, or you can stop there. There are many ways to do that, but one thing to notice here is that one is always better than the others, or some are always better. Typically, the best is always to leave the largest gap. If you leave the largest gap, you save the maximum distance. So the algorithm only needs to consider one of the best representatives. And finally, you can also do nothing. which gives us actually six ways to cross a vertical L. So that's a constant number, huh? So this is a key point. And similarly for horizontal transitions, you have only three possibilities: do nothing, go once, or go twice, with the corresponding distance each time. So if you look at the final graph we are going to build, actually the number of outgoing arcs are related to the possible transition. So we have at most six outgoing arcs when we are enumerating the vertical transitions, and we have at most three outgoing arcs when we are enumerating the horizontal transitions. Okay, let's look at this now with an example. We start from a source vertex and we start enumerating the vertical transition here. In this case, we do nothing and we reach the state 0, 0, 0 for a zero distance. In this case, we are adding this transition and we have 0, 0, E1 for a distance of 14. Another possibility is to do that and 0, E1, 0. Another option is to go once and we have 0, U1, U1, uneven degree and one single component, and so on. Let's pick this beginning for a path. I don't show the entire graph, but only a glimpse of it to understand it. And let's extend this vertex by the transitions by the transitions for the second part, the second block of the warehouse. And if I do that, for instance, if I am adding this transition, I reach a vertex, a subproblem, where I have three connected components, 1, 2, 3, and even degree for each vertex, E1, E2, E3, and so on. And if you look at this path, for instance, where I have reached two connected components and even degree, there would be another way to actually reach this vertex. If I had shown another path, I could have shown this path. What is interesting here is that you can see that actually, if you go down here instead of up, you would reach the exact same subproblem, but this path has a shorter distance than this one. The final configuration here has a length of 36 as opposed to 40. And it's best to leave this gap rather than this one. So that many paths lead to the same subproblem, because we are only looking for the shortest representative of this subproblem. And they have the same characteristic, both of them, E1, E1, E2. So when we solve a shortest path, we will build this best or shortest representative, and we will end up with the final optimal solution. So I hope this helps you to see that. Let's continue the example. We could continue from there and start extending this subtour with horizontal transitions. And in this case, we add nothing. So we are now using this separator and we are reaching a vertex E1, E1, 0. E1, E1, and 0. We could instead add one single edge, but that actually is not possible because this would give us an uneven degree here, which is not possible. So we can immediately get rid of this vertex from the graph. And we can explore the third option here with an even degree here. From there, we could look now at the second horizontal transition and again perform this enumeration. So I hope you can have some feeling for the graph structure and why a path in this graph is representing actually a tour in the problem. And the distance of this path is actually the length of the solution. One thing to notice is that when we finish the graph, we must finish with the final vertex that satisfies this property. And typically, this vertex would not be a valid one because it has an uneven degree. And a valid tour has only vertices of even degree. So this one would not be possible, and this one also would not be possible because it has two connected components. And at the end, we must have one single connected component. Okay, this is just to give you some insights. And notice that about this graph, that a vertex has at most six outgoing arcs. So number actually of the bound is given by the number of vertical transitions. So that's what really matters here to compute the size of this graph is the number of vertices, the number of classes of equivalence. And this is what we do to establish the complexity of this problem. We count this number. So recall the best known complexity for TSP is exponential in n. What we can do here is count the number of possible classes. And to do that, we start by building a bijection to a non-combinatorial object. And this actually relates to what is called the supercatalan numbers. So I'm not going into details here, but this is just to give you some insights of how we can start analyzing this algorithm. And this would lead us to this complexity already mentioned in the introductory video, and which is linear in n but exponential in h, which is therefore a fixed parameter tractable algorithm in h for this problem. And this algorithm makes sense if we have some applications with a low value for h. And that is the case for picking, where we can easily solve problems with six middle eights, which is large enough for most real-life warehouses. And a general TSP solver, a Traveling Salesman problem solver, would not actually be able to solve these data sets efficiently. And this is how we can handle a wide range of problems in warehouses. And you can have a look at the papers below if you want to know more. So I hope this helps you to understand better dynamic programming and also to see how fixed parameter algorithm can be designed to help in some real-life applications. Thank you very much for your attention. Have a good day.